The next 25 minutes, I'll give you an insight on my work and the things I've been doing. So I am an editor at the Austrian Public Broadcasting Service, ORF, and I work there at the news at ORF 1. And what we do is not only daily news, like the daily business, we do an hour of news every day. We're also doing documentaries, and every time around election time, we do experimental formats with political content. I want to give you an insight on the work and show you three different clips about these three parts of my work which I do. But very first, I want to start with why I'm editing. It's about passion, because I am passionate about my job. I'm passionate about my job because I'm passionate about creating. You know, that moment where all the clips you recorded and all the ideas you had on your storyboard come into the timeline. That's the moment where maybe things you thought they might work out for sure don't work out at all. Or maybe when things you thought they will never work out, they just really are good and go with the flow. I'm also very passionate about journalism, of course, as I work in the news. I have a master's degree myself in journalism, and I chose this technical kind of job. And also my friends and family have been asking me ever since, why are you not out on the field? Why are you inside an editing room, you know, like frame rates and codecs and all that? But I have to say, from a creative point of view, I am exactly where I want to be, because I hear the full story, I hear the full footage, and I hear what the people are saying in full length. So as a journalist is combining texts, I am the person who's doing a similar job, combining the pictures and the sound. And talking about sound, my main passion is music. I am a musician, I am a singer, privately. I make it as a big hobby, and I also play the piano. And that's what's triggering me in my work as an editor, because combining pictures, for me, is similar to combining sounds, composing music. So what's happening, because I also love the shortcuts, so very haptically speaking, sometimes when I'm making montage in my job, I really look like a DJ, like playing the piano. And I also feel like that because editing is so much more than just the technical part. It's really a creative job. So first, I want to talk about my serious business, the daily news where I'm working in. Here you see a picture of me in my workspace and a picture of me with the anchor woman. It's a very good shot. I'm working in ORF1 information, and we're producing 1 hour of information a day. So in the afternoon, we're making news flashes. We have two major news shows around 8 o'clock and around midnight. And the one which I want to talk about now is ZIP Magazine. It's a very nicely edited kind of information piece which we do every day. What we do there, for example, we focus on background stories to the bigger headlines, on soft news, or on social and political content, as well as international content. And we try to address a young audience. So we use music a lot, like indie pop. Personally, I have a large library of sound. And we also try to have a stylish appeal. We use motion graphics and flares and filters and edit it all in Premiere Pro. So that you get a look on an insight on how this might look, I'm going to show you one example.
Hat die SPÖ noch zum Strahlen gebracht, Bruno Kreisky. Doch heute haben die Roten an Glanz und Zugkraft verloren. Bei den unter 30-Jährigen haben diesmal nur mehr 17% die SPÖ gewählt. Bei der letzten Nationalratswahl waren es noch 20%. Noch mehr haben nur die Grünen verloren, von 21 auf 7%. Ein eindeutiges Angebot soll auch eine eindeutige Antwort bringen. So stellt sich das der schwedische Staat vor. Sex soll immer freiwillig sein. Die Regierung will das per Gesetz sicherstellen.
So, that's how it might look. The thing is, it takes a lot of time to produce these clips, because we really try to edit on the sound, we really try to have a nice imagery. So around 3 minutes of a story, they take around 3 hours to produce, mostly starting at 4 o'clock, and it airs a quarter before 8, so the time is always ticking. So I'm also the go-to girl when it's about sound. Like I said, I have a huge library, and mostly when we start, first we do a voiceover and we add the sound bites which the journalists pick for the story. And when the story starts, mostly we make a small collage with music, and that might take some time. Here in the background, I have recorded one of the last pieces which I made. And as you see, we go back and forth all the time. So you also need to adapt when, for example, after half an hour or an hour and an area of the edit is already finished and the journalists say, or you say afterwards, no, it's not in the right flow. You have to re-edit that. So you have to be all the time open to make changes to the timelines. You have to kill your darling consequently, because of course, every time you need to manage the length because it's going to be on air. So you always have to find the best pictures, of course, and a smooth way to combine them. But what I love about the process is mostly in my editing room, I manage to take the pressure out because the clock is ticking, of course, but we are here to make a good story. So mostly I really get lost in the pictures and I get lost in the story. I also have to listen to what is the content. So this is another layer of our daily work because you are the first viewer and the first listener to a story. So of course you have to be open about that as well. So mostly when the edit is finished, what I do is I use the Lumetri panel to make it look really even nicer than it is. As you can see here, I use an adjustment layer mostly, and I start the Lumetri panel. I add, for example, a small vignette to make it look a little nicer, right, like really just for the taste. And what I really like about the Lumetri panel is that you have, for example, in the creative tab, you have more look patterns where you can choose from to give your imagery the right look. Here, for example, I chose more saturation, and it really is a good style. And you can apply it on the whole timeline. And for example, if you have different kind of, for example, an outside scene, an inside scene, then you can just check the color bands for those segments. And when one clip is particularly dark or bright, then you can edit it on the clip directly. But mostly, I just edit it on the range in general. So this is how I use the Lumetri panel. And what I also like is that you have different kind of ways to use it. Like if I have more time, then of course I use the color wheels. But if I don't have much time, I just keep it in the simple color correction tab. And it's really good. You really get the good outcome which you want to have. And in the newest version of Premiere, there's also one new function of the Lumetri panel which I want to show you. I've had it last time in the news. We really didn't have much time, and we were at the press conference where there were three camera teams of ORF there, and all three teams had a different philosophy of white balance. So what happened, I got all this material, and this is one kind of live recording which I made. Like first, as I said before, I was just in the very simple, in a simple tab, and I used the eye catcher a lot, which you see there. I used the eye catcher to make it look more white, and then I add maybe a little contrast or a little black. And there were some interview passages made in the same situation. Oh, and this one is also nice. You can mask, of course. You can mask very, very easily the part which you want to correct. You can also add multiple layers of masks, but in this case, it's just very easy to demonstrate. I just chose that one to be the white focus. And we had their interviews with different persons in different times, but with exactly the same background. And they were not the same. So what I did, I chose the new function of the automatic. I'm sorry, I use the program in German all the time, so I need to check that out. I used the color match feature. So you can match the shot with a click. And it really just takes you on the left picture. You choose the direction, like this is the picture which I want to have. And on the right side, you have it's coming up soon. And on the right side, you have the picture which you want to correct. So on the left side, you think, okay, this is what my picture needs to look. And on the right side, you can just apply within a click how it's going to be. And if your outcome is not the way you want it to be, you can really just add the other functions so that it looks nicer. And I have to say, on that night, we have multiple departments in our company, and on that night we were the only news with just white on air, not multiple kinds of white. So so much about the daily business. Now I want to talk about the other things, about documentaries where we go in depth, meaning for a TV station, for people working in the news, We do not have months for a documentary. In the editing room, we have tops 2 weeks, which sounds very little, but when you come from the daily business, it's really a long time. So what I like most about starting documentaries, starting bigger projects, is that moment where you really have all the raw material in front of you and you need to organize it in a project. It might look overwhelming, but for me, it feels like conquering. It feels like conquering the raw material. And for that, of course, you need to have some tidiness. So I've become a very tidy worker. My workspace is even tidier than my living room, I have to say. And on the timeline, I also try to keep things as little as possible and just zoom out when I want to edit something in particular. You can see here as well how I organize my timeline. Here we were already from this project in a very, in a very late phase. So here you can see I add different color labels and they really help you to organize what you're doing. For example, different interview parts or different location parts, different scenes. And that way it's not only like one timeline, but you really see and after some time you really know when you get to get really fast when you want to change a particular scene in a particular time code. So, as an editor, of course, like I said, it's really not only about being a technician, but it's really about being creative. It's really about having an open eye and about an open ear. So what's happening from time to time, and that's the one story I want to tell, like to talk about now in particular, you really fall deep into a story. You listen to all the things that people are saying. Even when the job is done, you still scroll through the material. And that's what happened this year in the spring. We did one special documentary around the 80th anniversary of the beginning of World War II. And our angle, because we addressed the young audience, was the young audience. And of course, was being Austrian, dealing with the guilt, with the generation now, like asking, do they still have to feel some kind of guilt for what happened? So our anchor woman, she went on a mission to connect the layers between the last testimonials and the survivors of the genocide and the people, like the young people on the memorial sites with whom she met there. And what they did, they didn't talk to the camera, but they used their mobile phones directly to send us video messages. And it was a very strong piece. And I was very touched. I could put this together and I was very touched by the story. And so you can get an insight. I want to show you some small clips about how it was.
Wir waren gerade in der Gaskammer und bei dem Brennofen und es hat mich wirklich schockiert, weil ich kann es einfach gar nicht glauben, dass das mal wirklich passiert ist, Menschen passiert ist oder Menschen, das anderen Menschen angetan haben. Das ist echt ist.
Ich weiß gar nicht, wie man das eigentlich formuliert und weiß dafür eigentlich überhaupt keine Worte gibt.
Und wenn man vor dieser Gaskammer steht und sieht alles, es ist fast wie damals.
Diese Jugendlichen sind die letzte Generation. Die letzte Generation, die noch mit den Zeitzeugen reden könnte. Bald werden diejenigen, die es erlebt haben, nicht mehr unter uns sein. Noch können wir die Chance nützen. Noch kann ich Aber, Esther und Yehuda fragen, wie war das damals? Und vor allem, wie hat es begonnen?
Darf ich Sie fragen, persönlich, was Sie mir, meiner Generation, mitgeben wollen?
Ich bin ja kein Gott weiß was.
Dass ich nicht von Propaganda, von Zeitungen oder von Fernsehen oder von Radio nicht beeinflussen lassen, sondern so ein selber Ding, nicht blind folgen, Populisten oder Propaganda, ganz egal welche Seite.
Ich denke, jede Sache, auch die grausamste, kann Sinn haben, wenn sie den Menschen so tief irgendwo berührt, dass er sich zum Guten verändert.
Ihr habt keine Schuld an dem, was damals geschah. Ja? Aber ihr macht euch schuldig, wenn ihr über diese Geschichte nichts wissen wollt. Ihr müsst alles wissen, ja, damit so etwas nie wieder passieren kann.
So maybe you can imagine now why I really fell into that story, because it's not a story, but for me as an editor, I really deliberately, I just scrolled, I just listened to all the interviews in full length, and even with the archive and material, I felt like I have the chance to see something which I could never see otherwise. And on the other side, I do have some kind of responsibility to put it together, but in a way so that you can feel the empathy without thinking, oh, okay, why do they make this sound now? Why do they add that sound now? So it's a very, like, very delicate thing. But on the other side, it allows you to create this kind of empathy. And that's the magic moment that happens in the editing room, when you really feel that the words and the pictures and the sound, they flow together and they bring a feeling which you feel very strongly. And on the other side, when you send this, then you get the response that this feeling also goes beyond the screen and touches the people. Like, for me, that's why this production made very much sense, and I'm very happy to talk about it today. So, but of course, this production has also ended, and then came other ones. So, working in the public broadcasting service, one main topic of our work is also politics, not only in the daily business, but also when election time come around, we also make, like I said before, like political formats. And our approach to that thing is, you know, when you have election time, all the TV stations invite the politicians, and you have group discussions, and you have feature interviews, you have hot seat interrogations, and yeah, it's hard to do the coverage when you feel like when you make it, you already heard, you are already hearing what the people are going to say. So we need to make a different approach. And what we tried to start, and what we started there, was a half quiz, half talk show called Nationalraten. In English, it's called National Council, like National Counseling, but in German, Raten means guessing. So it was like a mixture between National Council and National Guessing. And the show worked like this. Every week, the leading candidate of a party, he was there for the show, and facing him was five contestants, and they were aiming for a prize. And the content of the quiz was the political message of the person, like personal question as well as questions about the party of the person who was there. Well, they were also confronting him or her in the talk show between the game rounds about the wrong messages or general disbeliefs. And as an editor, it was very stunning to see a format like this functioning. Like, it was information, it was entertainment, but both sides were really equally represented, and neither of the side was like not so much in front. And I think I'm just going to show you how it looked like.
Ungarns Premier Viktor Orban stellt sich klar gegen die EU-Flüchtlingspolitik. Im Oktober 2016 lässt er sogar mit einem Referendum über die EU-Flüchtlingsquoten abstimmen und erntet dafür viel Kritik, etwa von Seiten Deutschlands. Dazu behaupten wir, Sebastian Kurz hingegen fordert Verständnis für Viktor Orbans Vorgehen. Richtig oder falsch? Ihre Antwort bitte jetzt. Lass ich gerade noch gelten. Unsere Behauptung ist richtig. Einen Tag nach dem Referendum in Ungarn fordert Sebastian Kurz, wie gesagt, Verständnis für Viktor Orban.
Here, for example, after the message, we put the interview clip of him, and in between the game rounds were those talks with the politicians. So it was really like equally based. And what I found very, very fascinating about that production is to be there as an editor and also as an input giver from the scratch. Like, I was there with a group of people when we were really like rehearsing or trying to figure out like how could the game work and how could they be like in front of each other. And what made it also special was it was a pilot running a whole season, because you can't just do it one time with one politician and then say, well, okay, that didn't go well, so we're not going in to do it. And I was also there in the control room, which was like a very fascinating moment, because normally you have it when the people say, yeah, we're gonna make that in post-production. And this time I was really there. And the regisseur in German, she also turned back to me and I said, yes, we really can fix that in post-production. And also taking it to post-production, it was very, very thrilling to see most of the things really figured out well. And we had a very good thing coming on air around election time. So that's why I really have to say, as an editor working in my job, I'm really excited when it comes to election time, because you never know what's going to come next. So that's already the end of my presentation. Maybe one last input, because I was very reflective in the beginning of my presentation. Mostly, I also like the moment before you play out one clip, before you play out 1 hour. You see here is like more than an hour, but you can always zoom out so much that you think in the end, well, that wasn't so much. That wasn't so complicated, right? Although you really suffered through. Yeah, so thanks for listening. I'll be there if you have some questions. I'll be around and have a very nice day. Thank you very much.